worship with you. Whether you are here in person or joining us online, we want to welcome you here. So this morning, to prepare our hearts and minds for worship, we are going to participate in a responsive reading that comes from Psalms 95. So please stand to honor God's word as we stand and read together. I will start with the regular text, and you will respond by reading the bold text. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land.
Are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Amen.
So now, church, it is time to set our eyes on our Savior this morning as we sing and look to the sun.
The sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing his praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun. Oh, we look to the sun. Salvation tearing through the dead of night. See the kingdom burst into color at the speed of light. Freedom shaking up the atmosphere as the shadows fade into nothing as the day appears. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing his praises forever. To the sun. Creation waking up to kingdom come. See the hope of heaven shining like the rising sun. Now forever lifted up from death to life. There's no fear in love and no darkness in his endless light. Jesus, beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior. See the image of love, sing his praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun. Oh, we look to the sun. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God, beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun. To the sun, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, we look to the sun. Set our eyes on our Savior. See the image of love. Sing His praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun. Oh, we look to the sun.
His name is Jesus. Amen, church. Let's continue to focus, set our heart and our mind on Jesus this morning as we sing and celebrate the greatness of our God.
Dawn of creation, this world has been crying out for hope, for a hero to save us. We long for the supernatural, but there is only one God who can save the day. So clear the stage, prepare the way, 'cause heaven and earth are singing glory, hallelujah. Let the whole world see the greatness of our God. In awesome wonder, He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. Of our God. There's no one above Him. Only our Savior wears the crown. There's none who can stop Him. Not even the grave could hold Him down. But there is only one King who can save the day. So clear the stage, prepare the way, 'cause heaven and earth are singing glory, hallelujah. Let the whole world see the greatness of our God. In awesome wonder, He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. Of our God, the greatness of our God. We stand in awe and wonder, all the honor is yours. We stand in awe and wonder, all the honor is yours, Jesus. We stand in awe and wonder, awe and wonder, the greatness of our God. In awesome wonder, He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. the greatness of our God. The greatness of our God.
Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Fountain. My name is Josh Rahan. I'm the pastor here. It is good to be with you this morning. There's an old saying that you've probably heard that says you don't know what you've got until it's gone. And you don't know what it's like to not be able to come to in-person worship when you're not able to do so. And so over the past several weeks, our family has not been able to be here. And while I appreciate being able to worship online, I'm grateful for that ability to kind of stay connected. It is nothing like being in worship in person. Nothing like it. And so this past several weeks, it has been very, very challenging, I would say, for our family. We've been wrestling with and fighting against the COVID or coronavirus, if you weren't familiar with this. This began several weeks ago, with my youngest son, Andrew. He had been contact traced and was sent home. And so a couple days later, he began to show symptoms. And so we took him in and he tested positive. 4 days later, Debbie tested positive. 4 days after that, Will tested positive. And so I just figured, okay, I must be next. And yet I went in and for my test, and I was negative. And they told me, wait a minute. They told me that if you're negative, that means you have to wait until the last person in your household is finished with their 10 days of quarantine, and then you have to quarantine for 14 days after that. And I thought, oh, no. I don't know if you're supposed to want to test positive, but at that point, I wanted to test positive. I wanted to end this. And so I went back in a couple of days later, and sure enough, I was positive. And so last Tuesday was the end of my 10 days of quarantine, and it is good to be through that. It is great to be back, and it's great to be with you. Yep. It's been a crazy time within the life of our family, and what made this also kind of crazy is that we have a new family member in our new family member, and no, Debbie's not pregnant. I don't want you to think that. No, we have a puppy who has come into our life, and her name is Lucy. Lucy is a Shishan. That means she's a Shih Tzu Bichon mix. And she's only 5 pounds, pure black, everything on her. And yet, don't let that fool you. She is full of energy. And she is always go, 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 and is always running, running, running. And she has worn out 4 family members. Let me just say that. We didn't know how much work and effort it was going to be to get her ready to start training her. But she is always the center of attention. She wants to be petted. She wants to go for walks. She wants to play. She wants to play fetch. She wants to just do things constantly. And we're like, oh, can you just take a break, little one? We get so very, very worn out sometimes with her, but we have grown to love this little puppy, and she's become quite a princess within our family. And so when you are on a quarantine and there's not a lot to do at times, and you're thinking about, well, what are we going to do, and we have this little princess in our house, one of the things that you do, I guess, is you build her a castle. And so we built her a dog house for little Lucy, and it's complete with stairs that she can walk up. So there's two floors, and she's got carpet on both floors, and because you know she needs that to be gotta be comfortable as a puppy. And inside of the bottom floor, there's an LED light that can be turned on in case she gets nervous. You know, you're coming home to your castle, and you want to know what's inside. And so that's there, and it's great because she has not yet learned how to come down those steps. And so I can put her on the top floor in the morning when she's and let her sleep and rest there. I know where she is. She's not going anywhere. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. And so it has been a lot of fun to have her, but it's been challenging. Some of you who have dogs should have warned us better, but we are learning to train this little dog. And she's had to learn a lot of things. We had to teach her how to eat, how to and when to eat, how to go outside and tell us when she needs to go to the bathroom. Still learning that one. How to sit and play fetch and all kinds of different things. And so we're trying to train her as best we can. As I was thinking about Lucy over the past several weeks, I began to realize that, you know what? Sometimes we look a lot like a little puppy. Sometimes we, when we come to know Jesus and we give our lives to Him, the reality is we've got to change, and we've got to change parts of our life. And sometimes we bring a lot of baggage with us from our past, and we have to train. We have to change. We have to go through some training. So one of the things we have to do when we come to know Jesus is we got to learn how to eat. We've got to know how to open up God's word and how to eat from the bread of life and understand what that means, what that looks like. And some of us, we're kind of like puppies. We're still learning to do that, right? Some of us have to learn how to rest or get some sleep. We need to learn how to take a sabbatical and to get some rest from time to time. We're not good at that, so we need to learn how to do that. Some of us, we have to learn how to stop nipping or biting one another, right? Lucy likes to come up to us, and she'll kind of play, but she'll start nipping and biting. We're like, no, Lucy, stop biting. You got to stop this. And yet she just doesn't always figure that out. And sometimes in our lives, if we're honest as followers of Jesus, we can say things or do things which just irritate people, right? We got to learn how to be in a proper relationship with others. And sometimes, if we're honest, we make some messes, right? Like a little puppy. We make messes inside the church, just like little Lucy makes messes inside of our home sometimes. And so we will make these messes, and we get into these relationships with people, and we get fed up, and we get tired, and we say, that's enough, I'm done, I'm out of here. And we're like, whoa, 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 we need to come back together. We need to be in a proper relationship with one another. And sometimes in our life, we can look a lot like Lucy. We can look a lot like a little puppy, even as followers of Jesus. But the Bible talks about a way in which this can change, and it uses a particular word for how that happens and how that takes place, and it's called discipleship. Discipleship is the process of not just following Jesus initially, but following Him throughout the rest of your life so that you become more and more and more like Him. Dallas Willard puts it this way, and I love this quote. Think about this. He says, discipleship is the process of becoming who Jesus would be if He were you. I love that. Who Jesus would be if He were you. And so if He lived in Fountain Town or in this area where you live, if He went to work where you go to work, if He went to school where you go to school, if He lived in your family, discipleship is the process of becoming like Jesus if He were you. And so this morning, I want us to think about that. I want us to find out and discover what discipleship is, why it's so important, what Jesus expects out of you and me and those of us who consider ourselves followers of Jesus, how we grow as disciples both individually, personally, but also as a church family. Because discipleship is not just meant to be a personal pursuit. It's something that is done in community. And so this morning, I want us to explore that together. As we wrap up a series of messages called Reach, in which we've been talking about throughout this series, our 3-year strategic plan. God has revealed to us this idea that comes from his word all the way back in Isaiah chapter 49 and verse 6. And you might recall how in week one of the series we talked about in that verse, God said to his people, the people of Israel, I want you to be a light for the nations that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. And then we talked about on that same Sunday how the early church, Paul and Barnabas and others, Acts chapter 13 and verse 47, they took that verse and they said, really, that applies to us and our ministry. We are to be the light of the world. We are to be a light for the nations, and we are to reach out so that God's salvation might go to the end of the world. And so we said, that is our missions too. And we want to learn how to do that together over these next 3 years. And to do that, we're taking on three different initiatives. We want to reach farther, reach deeper, and reach younger. So reach farther. That's this idea of evangelism, sharing of the good news. We want to grow in our ability to share the good news of Jesus with those that we come into contact with. We also want to grow and reach younger. A couple of weeks ago, Andrew Birch spoke to us about what that looks like and how we need to reach into the next generation, right? That's the future of the church. We need to learn how to do that better and better as a church family. But we also need to learn how to reach deeper. That's discipleship. That's reaching deep inside of us and inside of the lives of our people in order that we can grow closer and closer to Jesus. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. I want us to just kind of, with that in mind, and that as a backdrop, just jump into God's word. We're going to be in John chapter 8, in the verses 31 through 38. And so if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me at this time to that passage of Scripture. And if you'd like to follow along with us online, you can do so by going to our online resource. It's called yourfountain.info. It's a great, great resource. We use it here at the Fountain, and it's been very, very helpful at this time, in which we're not yet handing out bulletins. And so if you go to .info, you can click on the Discover link, learn about a lot of things that are happening here within our church family. There's lots of other resources in that .info website, but also there's a Learn link, and you can go there, take notes today as God speaks to you, and keep them, email them to yourself. And so just know that that is available, and I would encourage you to use that. All right, with that in mind, let's jump right in. This is John chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. And we read this. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, we are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you. I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. All right, I want us to stop there for our time this morning. And in order to better understand this passage of Scripture, we need to know a little bit about what's going on. In John chapter 7, what we discover is that Jesus and his disciples have gone to Jerusalem as a part of a festival called the Feast of Booths or the Feast of Tabernacles. And this was a festival which was really a harvest festival, and they commemorated the Jews and celebrated in this week-long festival the goodness of God. God had provided for them, and they used this to remind themselves of a time within the history of the nation of Israel in which they were wandering in the wilderness. And so for a week, what they would do is they would set up these structures like this picture behind me, and they would live within these tents or booths in order to remind themselves of how God had provided for his people. And it was during this festival that Jesus goes to the temple each day and begins to teach. And in John chapter 8, it opens up with Jesus going to the temple, and he's beginning to teach, and the scribes and Pharisees bring a woman who is caught in adultery and place her before him. And they want to kind of trap him and trick him. They want to see what he's going to do. They expect him to condemn her, but instead, he forgives her. And he says that he won't condemn her. And as a result of that scene and that moment in his life, people begin to listen to him, and he begins to speak to him, and many begin to believe in him. And then we get to John chapter 8 and verses 31 and following, and Jesus then turns to those people that he's been speaking to, some of whom are starting to believe in him, and he says this, and this is the key. This is where I want us to focus our time for and our attention for this morning. Verses 31 and 32, Jesus says, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." You see, within these two verses, Jesus begins to give to us his definition and some explanation about what discipleship is all about. Discipleship is sometimes a confusing word, and sometimes we get kind of confused as to what it means, and what does Jesus mean when he's talking about discipleship? Well, I want you to notice and see some things that are happening within this verse, some lessons that we can learn about what discipleship is. First of all, discipleship is conditional. It's conditional. Jesus says, if you abide in my word, if you abide in my word, then you are my disciples. Reminds me of when I was in IT several years ago. I was a computer programmer, and whenever we would write programs, we would use logic to tell the computer what's to do. And so one of the ways in which you do that is what's called an if-then statement. So you might say, if x equals 1, then set this variable or run this function or run this code. But it's if-then logic. That's exactly what Jesus is doing here. He's saying, if you abide in my word, if you listen to me, if you remain in my word, if you obey my word, then you're my disciple. So that teaches us something very, very important. If we have a person who comes to us and says that they are a disciple of Jesus Christ, but yet we look into their life and we see these sins which they are participating in, and they don't seem to even be wrestling with it, right? They're just kind of doing these things, and we say, wait a minute. What is going on here? Jesus said, if you abide within his word, then you're his disciple. So what is happening here? That ought to be a concern for us when we see someone who says they're a disciple, but they're not continuing and to remain, to abide, to obey Jesus. Why? Because discipleship is conditional. Second, it's also educational. Discipleship is educational because Jesus says, If you abide in my word, then you're my disciples, and you shall know the truth. Knowledge. You see, discipleship is all about listening and following the rabbi. The rabbi is the teacher. Jesus is the master. We are his disciples, and that word just simply means a learned follower. We're his pupils. We're his students. And so Jesus wants us to gather near him, and he wants to teach us what he would have us to know. He wants to reveal truth to us. John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." He is the truth of God, revealed in human form. And so he wants to reveal that to us, and as we begin to take on that truth, we learn. There's a knowledge component to it. And so when we talk to a believer in Jesus who says he's a disciple or she's a disciple, we ought to be able to ask, okay, so what is the teacher teaching you? What are you learning? What is he saying to you? And if that person has some trouble answering that question, that's a cause for concern, right? We're not going to say they're not a disciple. We still need to talk to them. But that's a concern, because if they're a disciple, they're supposed to be following the rabbi, and the rabbi is going to teach. So what is Jesus teaching us? Discipleship is educational. And third, discipleship is transformational. It's transformational. It changes us. He said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall do what? Set you free." And what's very, very interesting about this is that Jesus goes on to describe what that means and what that looks like. The people listening to him, they get a little bit upset, and they're like, wait a minute, we're Jews. We've always been free. How can you say that we're now free? Our father is Abraham. And Jesus says, well, if you were free, then you would not be sinning, but you continue to sin. And so you're a slave to sin. But the Son, he's different. The Son is obedient to the Father. And so what is he talking about within this? He's talking about freedom from sin. He's not talking about physical oppression. He's talking about spiritual oppression. He's saying that when you come to know me, you come to understand my truth, you come to obey that and bring that into your life and begins to follow me, you're going to be set free from sin. It's transformational. And so discipleship is conditional, educational, and transformational. It should change our lives. If we're a follower of Jesus Christ, we ought to look different today than we did 6 months ago, a year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. We should be making steps, progressing, looking more and more and more like Jesus. That's what discipleship is all about. It's a personal pursuit. I began thinking about that this past week. And I began thinking about, you know what? What if we, in our pursuit of Jesus, were to take a notebook? Maybe we called it our discipleship journal. And what if we just began to write down and think about all the things that Jesus is teaching us? If we're his students, well, we need to take some notes, right? What is he trying to say to us? And so we open up God's word maybe on a Monday morning or a Tuesday afternoon or a lunch break at school or at work, and we begin reading, and we read these red letters, and we listen and hear what he has to say and started to apply that to our lives. So let me give you three questions that you can use this morning as application based upon this passage of scripture to help you to do that. To begin this journey personally. First question is this: what is Jesus saying to me? It always starts there. If Jesus is your rabbi, if Jesus is your teacher, then what is he trying to say? It's important, right? He said, if you remain, if you abide in my truth, then you will be my disciple. And so in order to do that, we have to listen, we have to learn, we have to ask ourselves, okay, what is Jesus trying to say to me? And that's very different from what is the person trying to say. When we listen to a pastor on a Sunday morning or we listen to a biblical teacher, we need to learn and understand what they're trying to say, and it's important to understand what the lesson or the point of the message is, right? But what we most need to hear is, what is Jesus trying to say to me? Which of these things that are being spoken of here speak into my life right now? What is Jesus, through his word, trying to say to me and where I'm at? That's the question. What is the rabbi trying to say to his disciple right now, right here, right now? And so we need to ask ourselves that question. What is Jesus trying to say to me? Number two is, what is Jesus asking me to do? Because it's not enough to simply have knowledge, right? Jesus isn't trying to make scholars, he's trying to make followers. He wants us to know what he knows, right, and what he wants us to know, but he also wants us to put that into practice, to have practical knowledge of what it looks like to follow him. And so we need to be asking him as we examine his word, okay, what is Jesus trying to say to me, but also what does that mean in my life? And that looks different in our lives. What is Jesus trying to say to me? What is he asking me to do based upon this truth that he's revealed to me? It's a very, very important question. And then third, what is Jesus promising me? Many times when Jesus speaks to us through his word, he gives to us promises. Now, sometimes he doesn't, right? Sometimes God in his word, God will just say, this is what the truth is, and you just need to believe it. It's like a good parent who says to their son or a daughter when asked for a reason, because I said so, right? We've all been there. We've all probably used that statement. It's a great statement. You need that from time to time, right? And sometimes within God's word, that's what God will say. God will say, listen, child, because I said so. You don't get a reason here. But many, many times Jesus gives us reasons, and God gives us reasons, and here he's given us a reason. Why should we know the truth? Because the truth will set you free. What an amazing promise. What a great reason for why we need to know what Jesus has to say to us and why he wants to change us, because he wants to transform us and make us into the image of him. And so these are three questions that we can use. I would encourage you, find a piece of paper, find a journal. Just start writing these things down as you read God's word. Don't just read it for yourself, but actually ask yourself some questions. Interact with the text and find out what is God trying to say to you. What is Jesus saying to me? What is he asking me to do? What promises is he giving to me? If I'm obedient to him, you'll be amazed at the truth that God reveals to you personally. But here's the thing. Discipleship is not just a personal pursuit. Discipleship is something that is done together within the community of believers. Jesus didn't just call one person to be his disciple. He had 12. There were different reasons for that, right? But one of the reasons for why he called 12 was so that they could talk to one another. How many times in the Gospels do we read instances when Peter and John and others are getting together and they're like, what was that? What did he just say? And they talk about it, right? They begin to interact and they say, well, I don't know, but it may mean this. And what about this? And as they do that, they begin to learn and grow together, putting into practice his truth. Same thing is true in the church today. Followers of Jesus today, disciples need to be not only pursuing discipleship personally, but also discipling others and being discipled by others in the church. It's very, very important that we do so. You know, Jesus, when he spoke to his disciples in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, he gave to us that great commission statement. You remember it? And what did he tell his disciples on that day? He said, go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all that I have promised you. And lo, I'll be with you to the end of the age. And so what was Jesus' command to his disciples? Go and make more. Make disciples. How do you do that? You baptize them, but you also teach them. They need to learn. They're like a little puppy. They're like little Lucy, right? They've got to learn, and it takes time. And they need to learn from those who have already learned from the Master. And we need to learn how to do that together. Francis Chan is a famous author and speaker and a pastor. And I love what he says about this. He says, for a person to be truly discipled and growing in their faith, they need more than one person discipling them. Have you ever thought about that? Do you believe that's true? Because I think that it is. Yes, we need to listen and learn from Jesus. Yes, we need to be able to hear his voice. We need him to speak to us. We also need to learn how to grow closer and closer to him, become more and more like him through one another. And we need to take on that mission to make disciples as individuals and as a church family. So how are we going to do that? Well, I'm glad that you asked. Because last fall, we began to talk about that as a church family and explore this together. And we had a group of people who got together. And one of the things that came out of those conversations was this need to grow in discipleship. And so we formed a discipleship team. And this discipleship team came up with a series of objectives and a metric. And so I want to quickly share those with you this morning. These are the things that they want to accomplish over the next 3 years. There's five of them. The first one is this, to identify, equip, and release leaders. Identify, equip, and release leaders. That means this team is going to be a part of identifying, equipping, and having developing leaders within this church who can go and make more disciples. More on that in just a minute. Number two is to develop an onboard a discipleship pathway. So when people come to our church family and they ask, okay, what is it that you're asking me to do? How do I grow as a disciple here in this place? We need to have an answer, and it needs to be crystal clear. And so all churches have different answers, and we are developing that. This team is helping us to formulate that answer, and it's always evolving and changing. And one of the things they're going to be doing is teaching some classes after Easter, which will go through topics like, how do I become a member? How do I learn about my spiritual gifts? How do I get plugged in? How do I serve in various ways? And there's many, many topics they're going to be teaching. And so just be on the lookout. There's going to be more information to come. Number three is to teach and preach Luke 9:23 Christianity. So what is that? Well, in Luke 9:23, Jesus says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. And so this is surrender. This is a form of Christianity that recognizes because Jesus is master, I need to surrender my life to him, and that's an ongoing thing. And so we need to be asking ourselves, well, how do I grow in this? What is it that I need to surrender next? What part of my life do I need to surrender to Jesus that maybe I haven't fully done yet? And so they're going to help us to learn how to do that. Number four, cultivate honest, urgent conversations with accountability. They're going to provide opportunities for us to come together, to learn, to grow together, and to have these kinds of conversations. And then fifth and finally, enhance and expand the life group ministry. Life groups at our church continue to be our number one adult discipleship ministry. And they're very, very important. But as our church continues to grow and as our life groups ministry grows, we need for some oversight and some help with this ministry. And so this team is going to help us over the next 3 years to provide that kind of oversight and help us move forward. And how are they going to do that? Well, part of it is that objective number one is to identify, equip, and release leaders into this discipleship ministry. But they're also going to help us to press forward and think about and dream about how can we move this ministry forward to become more and more important. And over the course of 3 years, it is our intention and my hope and prayer that that team will then form an oversight committee that will launch us into the future and be used to oversee this ministry moving forwards. And so this is the objectives that they are going to be taking on over the next 3 years. And we have a metric. How are we going to determine if we're successful? Well, our metric in the discipleship team is this. Every believer at the fountain is becoming like Jesus and by knowing and taking the next step of surrender. That's what I want to happen in all of our lives. I want every single person who is here at the fountains to know where I'm at spiritually and what is the next step that I need to take in order to surrender my life more and more and more to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We all need to have an answer for that. And this team is going to help us to grow in this ability and to have answers for that. It's not going to be easy. And at times, maybe even will be uncomfortable. I read an interesting story about a man who stepped into an uncomfortable situation. His name is Joe, and he stepped in and began to disciple a young man named Lecrae Moore. Some of you may be familiar with Lecrae. That's what he goes by. He's a hip-hop artist, a Christian rapper, and he's very, very famous, very, very talented. In fact, he has won multiple Dove Awards and even a Grammy. And at one point, his album called Anomaly rose to the tops of the charts in both the gospel albums as well as the Billboard's Top 200. It had never been done before. But Lecrae grew up in a very difficult situation. He didn't have a father, and he grew up in a family filled with abuse and neglect. And so at a young age, he began to venture out and to turn to things that were not going to be good for him. He pursued sex and drugs and alcohol and gang activity and theft and began to do all of these different things to the point where some of his friends referred to him as Crazy Cray. But then a man, a white man, stepped into his life, and his name is Joe. And Lecrae has talked about his relationship with this man. He said that when this man stepped into his life, he began to meet him where he was and stepped in his culture and began to speak to him. And suddenly he began to get it. And he began to follow Jesus, and it completely changed his life around. And he began to learn and to grow and to understand more and more about what it looks like to follow Jesus. And in this interview that I read about, Lecrae talked about what it looks like to follow Jesus. And he said that one of the things that is difficult for him and that he still wrestles with when he talks to other believers is that he said so many Christians have defined Christianity as being all about salvation and sanctification. In other words, about how we become a follower of Jesus and then what we avoid from that point forward. And while Christianity is about how we come to know Jesus, and it is about certain things that we're not supposed to do, what Lecrae goes on to talk about is he says, when you have a Christian worldview, when you're a disciple of Jesus Christ, you begin to see this world completely differently. And you see everything differently. Politics and issues of race and justice and things that are happening within our culture, and you begin to think about the music that you listen to and the things that you watch and the things that you eat, and everything begins to change because your worldview has changed. And suddenly it's not just about salvation and sanctification. And as I thought about that, I began to realize, you know what, I've been guilty of this. And I believe that the church many times is guilty of this. Because what happens is we get so very excited about what happens when a person gives their life to Jesus Christ and they enter into the waters of baptism and they are transformed, they're made into a brand new image, right? The brand new relationship with Jesus. And so they come up out of the water and we clap and we cheer and we're excited. But what happens then? Why don't we get just as excited when that same person says, you know what, I want to start coming to church on a weekly basis. You know what, I'm going to start tithing a portion of my income. You know what, I want to join with this thing you call a life group. I want to get into a Bible study. I want to begin to change the way that I eat and the way that I spend time with other believers. And suddenly they make all these changes within their life. Why don't we continue to cheer? Why don't we get so excited about that? That's discipleship, right? When that person is learning and growing and their life is continuing to change. And so I look at the times in my life and I think about the life of this church and I think about Christianity in general, and I think Lecrae is right. We do not get as excited as we should when we see people taking that next step of surrender. And we need to. Following Jesus is about evangelism. It is about reaching the lost, but it's also about training and equipping them to become more like him. And it's about that pursuit of discipleship. We're called to make disciples. And part of that is baptism, but a huge part of it, right, most of your life is really about training and equipping that person to become more like Jesus. I just wonder what that could look like in your life and in mine. You know, one of the things I love about a little Lucy is that every day we have this kind of routine. So after Deb and the boys go to school, Lucy gets tired. She's been up for a while. She gets up pretty early. And then she'll go and take a nap, and that's kind of a nice portion of the morning. But she'll take a nap, and then when she gets up, here's what she'll do. She'll come and look for me, and then she will come to my feet. She just look up at me with those big black eyes and just start whimpering and just waiting and start pawing, right? And so I'm like, oh, there she is, okay. And I'll pull her down, I'll bring her up, and I'll start petting her and talking to her. And she loves that. I started to think about that. I thought, what a great picture of what should happen in our life. Isn't that what should happen in your life and in mine every single day? We come to the feet of our master. We look up at Jesus with those big eyes and just stare at him and just whimper, asking him to just pick us up, right? And we just wait and we wait. And he looks down at us and he's the master, and he grabs us and he pulls us close. And he begins to speak to us in intimate terms and tell us what he has to say to us and help us to become more and more like him and love us. Do you understand that's what Jesus wants to do in your life? And mine. And he will, when we pursue this area, this discipline of discipleship together. Jesus will grab you and me, pull us close, and whisper into our ear and teach us how to become more and more and more like him. And show us how much he truly, truly loves us. And so this morning, as we stop and we consider these truths, I want you to see where we are headed in the next few years. I want you to pursue this with me. I want you to grow in your ability to understand and hear the voice of Jesus, to recognize what he's asking you to do, and understand the promises that he presents to us. And so this morning, as we stop and we consider these truths, let me just wrap up and leave you with this final thought. I want you to think about this over the next week. And that is this: reach deeper. Reach deeper and grow in your desire to be a true disciple. That's what God is calling us to do today. Not just today, though. Moving into the future. Let's pray. Father in heaven, God, I thank you for this day. Lord Jesus, we do come before your feet right now, each and every one of us. And we just stare up at you and we ask that you would draw near to us. Just pick us up, God, and begin to speak to us. Lord Jesus, teach us what you'd have us to know. Help us to long to be just as close to you as my dog, my puppy, longs to be close to the people within my family. And help us to view ourselves as just being your disciples, your students. We want to learn from you. We want to grow closer and closer to you like never before. And not only do we want to do that personally, Lord, we want to help others to do the same. Would you help us to make disciples for you? We love you, Jesus. And thank you this day for your word and pray all of this in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, this morning, as we continue within this time within our service, we're going to move into a time of response. And I want us to kind of reflect upon what we have learned. You know, for some of us here this morning, we need to recognize what Jesus said. When Jesus said that he would set us free, we would know the truth and the truth would set us free. And then he talked about how we have become enslaved to sin. Some of us here this morning, either here in person or listening online, needs to recognize that right now you are enslaved to sin. And what Jesus wants to do is to set you free. How did he do that? Well, he died on the cross for your sins and for mine. And so for some of us here this morning, we need to make a decision. Is that what we want within our life? And if you're here and you're listening and you can hear my voice and you know that God is speaking to you, then I want you to make that decision today. I'm going to be here in the back in just a couple of minutes. I would love to speak with you if you've got a decision to make. And for those of us who have made that decision, for those of you who are here and you say, you know what, I am a disciple, I'm a follower of Jesus, we need to draw close to our Lord and Savior. We need to allow Jesus to speak into our hearts and minds, our ears, and hear what he has to say. What is your next step of surrender? What is it that Jesus is asking you to do? And as we reflect upon those things, we're going to take a piece of bread, which represents his body, and a cup, which represents his blood. And we're going to remember what he did for us. And for those of us who are his followers, we may also want to participate in the giving of our tithes and offerings. And so we're going to do that together at this time as well. But let's move into this moment together and let's respond as God is leading us at this time.
Thank you.
Please stand and sing with us as we continue in our time of worship together.
Forgiveness was bought with
your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Amen. Amen. I love when we sing this next song because it allows us to reflect on all the times that God has been faithful, of when he has stepped in a big way. So I don't know what you are going through today, but as we sing this song, my prayer is that you will come to the conclusion that your confidence, my confidence is not anything I have done, anything that I am doing. My confidence is in the nature of a loving God. My confidence is knowing that his promises still stand. My confidence comes from knowing that God has never let me down, and he's not going to start now. Let's sing. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Oh,
mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it.
the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. Oh, make a way, Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Oh, you've never failed me yet. And I never will forget that you never failed me yet. And I never.
God has certainly moved mountains within the life of our church family, and we are so very, very blessed. Yes. We've seen him do it. We'll only want to see him do it again. What a great, great song to wrap up our time of worship and to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Before we are dismissed, I have two very quick announcements for you. I would encourage you to go on your phones to .info and the Discover link. There are a lot of things going on here at the Fountain, but two that I want to bring to your attention. And the first has to do with tonight, our youth group is going to be meeting from 6 to 8. And so I want to encourage you to bring your young person, have them bring a friend and have them come, because we are having lots and lots of young people come. Andrew told me we had 20 or so last week, which is incredible. Yeah. And we know that can continue to grow, and as this church opens up, we're going to see God move in a powerful, powerful way. So we're excited. Bring that young person tonight. That's going to be a great time this evening. They will have a great, great time together. And then second, one of the announcements found under the God sightings, the praises in the announcements, is that on March the 20th, we're going to be opening up the entire building, and so that's not far away. Yeah. We finally have a date. Yeah. With that being said, I want you to be aware that there's going to be a lot of things kind of going on. We're probably going to need some of your help to help move things around, to clean and get prepared, and there's going to be need of that. But we need everybody to be praying so that when that happens, when that takes place on that Sunday morning and moving forward from that point, we'll have this entire building just filled and have ministry going on in different areas. And so there's a lot coming, a lot going on. God is certainly at work within this place, and we have a lot to be grateful for. So with that in mind, let's remember those truths. As we leave this place, let's remember what we're called to do. We're called to make disciples, and let's remember that God is wanting to, what he's wanting to do in this place, that we might reach people for Jesus over these next 3 years. We can do that together, and we will. So have a great, great week in the Lord, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Hasn't happened yet.